Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for being here and joining us for another event in our series of community conversations. This is the fourth series that we have done. This is the second event in this series. Our first event was about severe food allergies, and it was really fascinating. And if any of you have someone that would be affected by that, I would encourage you to go to the YouTube, the city's website, and also then look for that particular YouTube event. You might be very interested in what they had to say, especially about some emerging trends that are happening. Also, we have another community conversation coming up. The card is on your chair, and the next one is on December 7th. This is going to be fascinating as well, because 3 years ago we brought together some healthcare leaders. This was before the Affordable Care Act, all of those kinds of things, and we asked them to talk about the landscape of healthcare in our community. Presidents of both hospitals, CHI St. Elizabeth and Brian, as well as the head of the health department and a local physician, and we asked them to talk to us about what they saw coming. Well, since that time, a lot has happened. A lot has happened in the last week, actually. So things are really changing again. And we would like to go back and revisit that conversation, remind them about what they did talk about 3 years ago, and then have them kind of reflect on where perhaps they had great insight, where they didn't, and what they see for the future. So I think it'll be really fascinating, and I hope you join us there as well. But today we are going to talk about an amazing and difficult issue in our community. Today we're going to talk about opioid addiction, and I can tell you a couple of things, and that is that more Americans die from drug overdoses than in car accidents. I can also tell you that opioids cause more deaths than all other drugs. That in itself should tell us that we have to begin to think about this very aggressively. Now, I think that in Nebraska we can say that, like in most cases, we do things a little bit better than most people. Perhaps it hasn't reached the state that it has in other places. But I can also tell you that the deaths from opioids in Nebraska has more than doubled in the last 15 years. So this is a concern, and it is an issue that we need to address. It does affect every race, ethnicity, it affects every socioeconomic level. As an emergency department physician said once, it's not the kind of addiction that you can often tell who has it. It's often people that you may know in your own neighborhood, in your own school, in your own church. So we have this outstanding panel with us today to talk about this. We will not only hear about an incredible story of recovery, and no offense to the rest of the panel, but those are incredibly powerful stories, and so you get to hear one of those today. But we're also going to hear about state and local efforts that are going on right now, things that we hope to do here, hopes for the future in this particular area. So it's my pleasure to introduce the moderator for today, Phil Tegeler. Phil, many of you will know, is the director of the Bridge Behavioral Health. That is 8th and K, am I right? 8th and K, one of those big, tall brick buildings down there. And Phil is just one of these guys who goes about the business of doing some incredible work in the community. He has a staff of 50 folks who work. What did that facility used to be? It was a tractor.
Started its life as a tractor showroom and warehouse.
Yes. So, and right now there are 50 staff there that are going about the business of guiding people from safe passage through from addiction to sober living. That's what's happening behind those walls. They offer this specialized, medically supervised withdrawal for folks who find themselves in a position to need that, and also inpatient and outpatient treatment. A lot of great stories of recovery that are happening over there. And they just got their first recovery dog.
Therapy dog.
Therapy dog. So apparently the dog is very tired from all the attention that it's getting. Yeah. Phil has an incredibly interesting history, because he not only has experience in the development and management of employee assistance programs, but he's also served 10 years as senior director of global marketing for MDS Pharma Services that was based in Lincoln. And so he not only has experience as a small business owner, but as a private practice clinician and now a nonprofit director. So a very interesting history that he has. He went to Dana College, and also got his master's degree in public education, public administration from the University of Nebraska. So Phil will introduce the rest of the panelists, but I'm very, very happy you're all here today, and join me in welcoming them all.
Thank you, Lori, and certainly welcome to members of the panel, and welcome to you all today. It's good to see a full house as you participate with us in this discussion on the issues involved in our country's growing addiction to prescription medications. Thanks to the Health Endowment for sponsoring the forum and for all that they do to help us as a community to become healthier for those of us that live and work in the community. Lori mentioned a couple of statistics. There are many out there, and I will offer four as a place to begin this discussion I'd like to focus on in terms of perspective. The first estimate is that one in five of us in this country who are age 12 and older has used prescription medications for non-medical reasons at least once in our lifetimes. Second is that last year an estimated 2.1 million Americans used prescription drugs for non-medical reasons for the first time, and that averaged about 5,750 people a day in this country who used prescription medication for non-medical reasons for the first time this last year. Since 1999, so over the last 16 years, the amount of prescription opioids sold in this country has nearly quadrupled. And yet there's not been an overall change in the amount of pain that Americans have reported during that period. And each day, on average in this country, more than 650,000 opioid prescriptions are written. 650,000 prescriptions a day. Certainly, we've got a growing issue with prescription drug addiction, including an increase in addiction to opioid pain medications that many in this country are calling an epidemic. We're now locked in a battle to identify strategies to address the issue. We're faced with limited resources, including a lack of treatment alternatives. Like most issues, however, addressing this issue starts with education. And that's really why we're here today. Welcome and introduce panelists. First, I'd like to introduce Melody Henderson. Melody is directly to my left. Melody is a native of Nevada, Missouri, and she currently lives in Cook, Nebraska. Cook is a little bit south of Syracuse here in Nebraska. A learning disability made school difficult for Melody, and she left school and was on her own by age 15. She's been married for 18 years and is the mother of three boys, ages 15, 12, and 7. After giving birth to her youngest son by cesarean section, Melody was prescribed hydrocodone for pain. Soon after, she discovered that hydrocodone didn't get rid of just her pain. It also helped her feel better and more productive. That began a 7-year journey with addiction and now recovery. Melody's been clean and sober for 11 months. Melody, would you please give us some perspective?
Hello, my name is Melody Henderson. I am a mother of three boys. My husband and I have been together for 22 years and married 18. I have three sisters, a great mother and father. I noticed from a young age I just didn't belong. I was born with a learning disability, depression, and anxiety. I always felt like I have a very high addictive personality. I have a family history of addiction. I wasn't diagnosed until I was 25 years old. Therefore, the time before my depression meds, I felt there was a void in my life. I started drinking. I smoked pot. I never imagined addiction would be a part of my life. I always said, drugs are awful. I don't understand why they just don't quit. Man, was I naive. I didn't understand addiction until I had my third son. I had a C-section. The medicine made me feel great. I could take care of three boys, work, keep up on the housework, all with a smile and a feel-good attitude, until everything came crashing down. I got 2 months worth of hydrocodone. Once that was gone, I found myself looking for more. So I would buy them off the streets. Every house has some kind of pain medicine. Once I couldn't find them, so I went to the dentist. He ended up giving me 30. I had a tooth pulled for pills. When I was running out, I'd get sick as hell, almost feeling like you're dying. After about three times of this, it hit me. I have a major problem. I was detoxing. I had no idea how this all got started. I was stuck in a cycle of hell. That was the beginning of my fall. I so badly felt I needed to use. I wanted it more than food, water, air, family, friends, and children. I never imagined I'd be addicted to drugs. I truly wanted to stop, so I went to the hospital for help. I would sober up and be clean about a week. It is a one-track mind of an addict. My brain wouldn't stop ever. The hospital put me on meds for my mental illness. I still would fail. With all I had great ambition to stop, I went to the hospital to detox about seven times. Nothing was working. I had treatment for about a week. I had to use. I ended up back in the hospital. Finally, after seven long years of hell and misery for my children and husband, I didn't care of losing it all, as long as I could use. Imagine how my boys must have felt. I was running to use every day. If anyone got in my way, I'd go crazy manic. Sorry. Brian and I fought all the time. The children suffered, wondering why I couldn't just stop. Thank God, finally, the last time I ended up in the hospital, a doctor recommended Suboxone. I stayed clean long enough to start my Suboxone. Dr. Schmidt and his nurses are my angels. They have saved my life, my marriage, and my family. Sorry. Suboxone stops the thought process. I wasn't thinking about using after seven long years of having to use every day or detox. Finally, no thoughts. At times, there was about five to six people selling or trading pills in our town of 300 people. We never had to leave town to use. Most addicts, doctors shop ER to ER, town to town. Doctors don't realize they need to wing people off these drugs. Also not supply it to every cramp, cough, or little pain. People, addicts, will tell their doctors, dentists, family, friends, anything to make excuses for using. If I was out, I'd sleep for 3 or 4 days while my husband did everything for our boys. Thank God he stood by my side and helped me through my sickness. He is my soulmate. Now using Suboxone, I could have my life back. I was very suicidal, addicted with depression and anxiety. God saved me. I found Dr. Schmidt. He is my hero. The girls at his office and Dr. Schmidt helped me to take the first step. Without Suboxone, this would have never been possible. I go to a med doctor for my mental illness and medication. I also see a counselor. Without all three, I wouldn't have stayed clean. Suboxone helped push all the thoughts of using out of my head. My family knows this saved my life. Finally, I can be a loving, kind-hearted person. I know I am. Addiction affects everyone, rural towns, big cities, rich, poor, PhD, or dropout, for addiction is not prejudiced. I feel with the right help, education, we can save so many people. That is why I am here speaking today, to educate and inform. Please know there is a major epidemic. So many are dying. Imagine if this was your mother, sister, or daughter falling straight into hell, so close to death, nothing you say can help. You are stuck. They can't stop, or they feel they would die. As a family member, you want to say stop, just stop. You can't fix them. You don't have the tools or education. For the addict, this is a very lonely world. No way out. Maybe death was always a thought. I am so very thankful Suboxone has pulled me through. We need support teams, counseling, and Suboxone. I feel this is so important to saving lives. Through education, a loving support group, and counseling, we must never forget the addict who still suffers. We need to inform, educate, teach more addicts. There is a way out. Suboxone was my way. Thank God this is my miracle.
Thank you, Melody, for sharing those thoughts with us. Folks, the goal is to have the panelists each speak, and then there'll be time afterward for some questions. I'm sure you all have questions you'd like to ask as well. Next, I'd like to introduce Dr. Kelly Zock. Kelly is an Omaha native. He graduated from University of Nebraska Medical Center College of Medicine in 2011. He's completed residency training in anesthesiology at the Mayo Clinic. His interest in pain management has led him to continue his training and complete a fellowship in interventional pain medicine at the Oregon Health and Science University in Portland, Oregon. Dr. Zock is board certified in anesthesiology and board eligible in pain medicine. He believes in a multidisciplinary approach with the use of interventional treatments, medical management, rehabilitation, and alternative modalities. In Lincoln, Dr. Zock practices with innovative pain and spine specialists. Dr. Zock?
Thank you. And thanks for having me here today. And Melody, thank you for your story.
Thank you.
Like you said, I'm an interventional pain management specialist. I just started helped start a practice here in Lincoln. Treating pain has become basically my passion. I think pain is complex, and chronic pain is very complex. Historically, I think the treatment of pain was oversimplified. Am I close enough to the microphone? The thought always was that you have pain, here are some pain medications. The pain gets worse, here are some more pain medications. You start to get used to the pain medication, let's increase the dose, let's go higher and higher and higher, and that was really the only thing we had. Now I think the treatment of pain has become more complex because we understand pain a little bit better. That sounds counterintuitive, but I think that the reason that we're in this position now is because we oversimplified it in the past. The way I treat pain now is I try to take a comprehensive, multidisciplinary, integrative approach to it. Pain is not just pain. It's physical, it's emotional, there's a spiritual component to it. The definition of pain actually is that it's basically an unpleasant physical and emotional response to some unpleasant stimulus. So the treatment of pain should be complex, and it should be more than just pain medications. Pain medications do nothing more than stop the body from perceiving the pain. They act at the level of the spinal cord and at the level of the brain. They remain the best option in terms of stopping the pain. They really do. However, they also have long-term implications, as we have heard. And it's not the patient's fault all the time. I mean, we are the ones that have, as a provider, I feel, you know, partially responsible for it. And so when I treat pain, I try to take that approach, that it should be multidisciplinary, it should be comprehensive. So what does that mean? It means trying different kinds of medications, okay? Non-opioid medications that the research has showed works better for pain and doesn't have the long-term consequences. It's perhaps doing injection therapy. There's all kinds of injections that we do for pain. It's physical therapy. So it's engaging in some kind of active lifestyle that not only improves the pain, but also improves your well-being. It's potentially doing some kind of behavioral health modalities. There's pain psychologists who do biofeedback and cognitive behavioral therapy and meditation, mindfulness, that helps. It's acupuncture, chiropractor, alternative treatments, complementary treatments. And so, you know, I always tell my patients that we need to exhaust every option. Rarely do I cure pain. The running joke in our clinic is that once in a while, patients get completely better. That's rare. I think importantly, what I have tried to do is basically say that chronic pain is a disease in and of itself, and there's no cure for it. And so we have to do different things to try to, you know, manage the pain a little bit better, whether it be the physical therapy, the psychology, the acupuncture, the injections. And if you can do a little bit of all of those, hopefully we can improve your quality of life, improve your function, and make you feel better about yourself. So I just want to say thank you for having me here. And I really especially want to thank Melody for her testimony today, because it is a big problem. And every time I write a prescription for a pain medication or send a prescription to the pharmacy, I think two or three times before I do it. Is this patient the right patient for this? Am I doing the right thing long term for this patient? And if I can honestly say that I am, then I still think it's a good treatment, but I want to be responsible for this epidemic that we're faced with. So thank you again.
Thank you, Dr. Dunn. Next, I'd like to introduce Kevin Borcher. Kevin is a registered pharmacist and the Prescription Drug Monitoring Program Director for NEHI, which is the Nebraska Health Information Initiative. Kevin's responsible for implementing the Nebraska Prescription Drug Monitoring Program, or PDMP. I'm sure there's a way to pronounce that more succinctly, but that's what I have. As a part of a statewide strategy to enhance patient safety and prevent adverse drug events, this program will eventually require that all prescriptions dispensed in Nebraska be reported to a central database. Prior to his current position, Dr. Borcher was the pharmacy informatics coordinator at the Nebraska Methodist Hospital for more than 19 years. He's had experience in implementing and maintaining several automated and computerized patient safety programs. Dr. Borcher is a graduate of the University of Nebraska Medical Center College of Pharmacy, and he has completed his residency in Phoenix. So, Dr. Borcher.
Thank you very much, Phil. I am very glad that you were able to allow me to come today. We have all heard that prescription drug abuse and prescription opioid abuse and overdoses have become an epidemic or a crisis. Many of us in this room know of someone that has been impacted by this. And Melody's story is just one that we've heard, very similar to others. There are several opportunities and modalities that are going on in the country to try to help this, and on many different levels. When I was on the board of pharmacy 13 years ago, we've started looking at prescription drug monitoring programs. Every other state except Nebraska and now Missouri doesn't have a fully implemented PDMP. Nebraska was able to get a PDMP on the books in 2011. So we had something, but there were some gaps in that program where patients could actually opt out. They could say, I don't want my information shared for my doctor or pharmacist to look at. So that's a gap if someone is looking for that. There are now some opportunities going across the country to try to help some of this in many different ways. Appropriate prescribing is one. The CDC released some documents in March of this year to give some guidelines for prescribers to maybe do some more appropriate prescribing. And Dr. Zach had mentioned several of those that are non-pharmacologic, non-drug related to start with, or maybe using different doses, maybe using something like Tylenol or Motrin instead of some of the opioids. And so there are a lot of different opportunities there. Lowering those doses. The state programs across the country are starting to put in dose limits where if it's greater than, let's say, 150 doses in a month of your OxyContin or Vicodin, there's going to be a limit where those prescriptions could be rejected, and you'll have to go back to the physician to get different quantities or different prescriptions. There's something else that has been started about 2 or 3 years ago, and that's electronic prescribing of the controlled substances. It's still relatively new. The DEA allowed it starting in 2010. Nebraska actually leads the country in electronic prescribing. And what this does is prevent some people who are in such bad need of getting their opioids or other drugs that they may take some prescription pads out of their doctor's office or write up their own prescription pads. And this is a means that's very secured where the doctor can write the prescription electronically on their computer and it goes directly to the pharmacy. So there's no way to get that prescription altered. It's very secure. So that's another way. Another method that we're seeing to try to help curb some of this is through drug take-back programs. You may have heard about that on TV, where this allows pharmacies working in conjunction with law enforcement and the DEA to have you take your prescriptions that are unneeded, unwanted, outdated, and bring them to somewhere where law enforcement can take care of those and have them properly destroyed. There right now may be 2, 3, 4 of those a year. The DEA may ramp up on those again. And then there's another piece that the DEA is allowing where community pharmacies can start to take those back. By law, the pharmacist can't touch those medications that have already been dispensed, but there's almost like a mailbox in some pharmacies, and there's a website you can find out from the DEA where in your community those are. So you can take them there and you can dispose of your unwanted medications. If a pharmacy doesn't have those, you can also be given an envelope, and most pharmacies have these where you can put your medications in those, seal it, and mail it off, and it goes directly to I believe it is the DEA office where they'll properly destroy that. So that's another type of system across the country that's been growing to try to help get rid of those. For those first-time users who might be misusing for non-medical purposes, about 68% start by getting their medications from friends or family. If you have someone who was on, maybe grandma had some pain medicines in her medicine cabinet from 4 or 5 years ago, and maybe a friend, family member, a salesman comes to the door and asks if they could use your bathroom, and they'll rummage through medicine cabinets or drawers trying to find something like that. So getting them out of your possession and somewhere safe where they can be properly destroyed is another way to try to cut back on that supply where a lot of people start off. Another opportunity to try to help reduce some of the abuse and misuse and give prescribers and dispensers a little bit more opportunity to see your patient profile is the PDMP. The Prescription Drug Monitoring Program has been around for several years across the country. Now we're down to just one state that does not have a PDMP. Nebraska is implementing theirs in full force beginning January 1st. And what this does is it requires all pharmacies to send records of their prescriptions from controlled substances, your narcotics, your opioids, your Xanax, Valium type medicines, to a central database. And then while your pharmacist, your physician, anyone who's authorized to use that system can look up your patient profile while you're there and see if maybe are you getting your medicines filled too frequently or maybe not frequently enough, and that's why you're having pain. So it's a tool to help the prescribers and dispensers look over and make sure that you're getting the most appropriate therapy possible. It's not meant to be a punishment or a witch hunt for anyone. It's meant for medical purposes, and that's the way the law was written at this point. So with a lot of these different prongs to try to help reduce some of the misuse that may be going on and to improve patient care, we might be able to make a dent in this.
Finally, I'd like to introduce Chris Peterson. Captain Chris Peterson is a native of northern Minnesota, graduate of both Concordia College and the University of Nebraska at Omaha, with degrees in organizational management and public administration. He's a 25-year member of the Lincoln Police Department and has spent more than half his career as a narcotics investigator. He served on the Lincoln-Lancaster County Narcotics Task Force for more than 14 years. The mission of the task force is to identify and investigate mid and upper level drug distribution to positively influence the quality of life in our greater Lincoln community. Captain Peterson, welcome.
Thank you, Phil. Thank you, everybody, and I appreciate the invitation to be here to share information that we might have from a law enforcement perspective and to potentially be part of a positive solution. I wish I could tell you that the painful story that Melody shared with us was but a few stories that we've heard, but it's a very regular story that I and other investigators have heard over the last several years. And while we have not experienced the illegal opiate drug trade that everyone tells us is coming this way, and I suspect will continue this direction, we have experienced a very consistent and strong presence of prescription drug abuse and the illegal sale of those drugs, as Melody described, in Lincoln and Lancaster County. some of what we have seen change, as opposed to just pure numbers of what we've seized, is the type of drug that we are seeing, the type of drug that we're seizing, and the age ranges of those that are involved in it, unfortunately. And it does appear to get younger. It doesn't escape our college nor our high school campuses at all. And what we are seeing is that there is a greater presence of the opiate-based pills, including the hydrocodones, the oxycodones, and the oxycontins. And the overlap, of course, that I would come into contact with those is going to be an illegal context, whether it's someone that possesses another person's prescription drugs, or our officers are either seizing those drugs on the street, or we're actually buying them in an undercover capacity. And while I can't tell you that's an everyday occurrence, it's very much more regular and more frequent than you would care to admit. What we are seeing in addition to that is that periodically Lincoln will have a spike in those illegal opiate-based drugs like heroin, and approximately 2 years ago we had a number of heroin overdoses, and several of those did result in deaths. And one of the strategies that we were able to use as a platform were those who were using opiate-based prescription drugs, and it led us to a path where we were able to identify who the source was and how they were bringing those drugs into Lincoln. And it helped us stem some of the distribution here in Lincoln, but it's never completely gone away like it has 5 and 10 years ago. It's continued to be present. It's just a lot more covert than it had been in the past. Unfortunately, as Dr. Borcher described, with Nebraska being one of the few states left to have that active prescription drug monitoring program, the other states who do have those programs have seen the squeezing or the limitation of prescription drugs being available, and it's increased the illegal substitution of those drugs, and in particular heroin and some of the related adulterants that are in them, such as fentanyl. We believe that may be one of the unintended consequences with doing a better job of managing pain and the ability to monitor those prescriptions. And unfortunately, I believe that we will see some ripple effect. It's very difficult to measure how much of an effect or when that will take place. But my colleagues along the East Coast, where heroin and cocaine are more prevalent than what we experience with methamphetamine in the upper Midwest, will tell me and others, both professionally and in public, that it does continue to march westward, and it's present in every state around us. And while it's here in smaller quantities, the intelligence or the word on the street that we get and the small seizures that we're starting to see would indicate that there's an ever-increasing presence here. The presence of the pills that I was describing has remained relatively consistent. Year to date thus far, just the narcotics unit, so not the entire Lincoln Police Department or Lancaster County law enforcement agencies, we've seized more than 2,400 pills that people possessed for illegal reasons. So it wasn't somebody wanted to turn them in for a drug take back program or any of those types of programs, or simply turn them into the Lincoln Police Department. There's been more than 2,400 that we've seized through the first 9 months of the year that someone was either arrested for, or they didn't have the proper prescription or the legal means to acquire them. And I'm very happy to be here to help discuss some of those solutions and share what I do know of any of the ripple effects that may come our way as a result of trying to do better with prescription pills and our management of those processes.
We'd like to take some questions, and I would imagine panel members that we're here because we're interested, but some of what you shared has really gotten our attention just from the comments so far. So one question I start out with is, my sense is that we've had prescription medications in this country for a long time, and yet we're talking today about an increase maybe of epidemic proportions. So any sense of any of the panel members, what's changed? Why the trend? Why now are you sharing information with us that really grabs our attention about how serious this epidemic is coming to be? Anyone?
Well, we are seeing more deaths. Those deaths are increasing due to prescription drug overdoses, as well as non-prescription, the illegal illicit drugs. We're seeing just a ballooning effect of more and more people dying, either going to the emergency departments for overdoses and living, or not living. And that's grabbed the country's attention on people are dying. People are dying in Nebraska as well as the rest of the country. Maybe that number of deaths isn't as great in Nebraska as it is across the country, but we still have deaths occurring in this state and in the communities that require some type of greater attention and solutions to prevent these deaths.
Any other comments? Questions from the group for the panel?
So Abigail Swatsworth with CenterPoint, and we definitely see an increase in this kind of addiction. And Melody, I want to start by saying thank you for sharing your story and for sharing your struggle with mental illness in addition to addiction, which we see so often go hand in hand. I think one thing we need to do is get more prescribers, more psychiatrists and APRNs educated in terms of medication assisted treatment so that we have more Suboxone providers available. But I'm sort of wondering if there's a perspective or if someone can respond. Do we think that managed care and the effort at seeing more patients in a shorter amount of time have in some ways led to doctors being more complacent about pain management and oversimplifying and sort of the trends and changes in how healthcare is provided? How do you feel that that has impacted the issue?
Yep. I can speak to that. I think that no doubt that has played a role. For instance, anytime I see a patient who I'm going to prescribe a pain medication for or who wants a pain medication, there's a series of steps that go into it. So it starts with an evaluation of the patient, obviously, and kind of trying to identify the root of the cause of the pain. Because pain, like I said, is complex and there's different types of pain. So opioids don't treat all the types of pain, okay? So it starts with that. If I end up deciding that I feel like opioids are indicated, then the next step is to ensure that we analyze the pharmacy records, number one, because I want to make sure that I'm the only one prescribing for the patient and that the patient isn't getting the medications from, you know, various ERs around the area, various other providers, because that gets messy, as you can probably understand. Another step is to do a urine drug screen, which serves a purpose of identifying that the patient is taking the medications the right way, that they're taking the ones that they're prescribed, and that they're not ingesting other types of drugs, you know, illicit or prescribed. And so that's important. And so those take time. And then once I've made that decision, then the decision becomes, what is the right dose for the patient? How much should I give? How soon should I, or how frequently should I follow up with that patient? So it's so complex, you know. So every time I decide to prescribe, there's three or four or five or six steps that go into it. And so I think it has become the easy answer is to just give out the pain medication, right? I mean, it takes no time at all, and the medications work. They work great. So that's the issue. And so I think that, has led to, that's part of the problem. I hear, stories from people who have a tooth pulled and they get, 60 oxycodone prescribed. That's not appropriate. It needs to be, you know, you need to, whatever the cause of the pain is, pain typically doesn't last for long, especially acute pain. Now there's chronic pain, it's a different story. But acute pain tends to resolve within 3 to 5 to 7 days. So, you know, you should probably prescribe only 3 to 5 to 7 days worth of medications, that as opposed to giving a 30-day supply. So yeah, I think that's absolutely led to part of it.
Other questions?
Start here.
I'm Rhonda Woodside. I'm a nurse practitioner at First Step, and many of the same issues that CenterPoint has. Probably 90% of my patients already have addiction of some sort and mental health issues. If I prescribe narcotics, I require them to have a drug and alcohol substance abuse eval. Sometimes that chases them out the door, but it gives me a clue on how to treat them overall. My other frustration is, like you talked about the insurance companies. I totally agree with Dr. Zock about all the different things we should do, but insurance won't pay. Insurance won't pay for acupuncture. They won't pay for therapy. They won't pay for the chiropractor. That's so frustrating when the patients, I think, would do it, but there's no coverage for those alternative. I'm hoping that's something that's going to change with the new healthcare system, because I don't know how else we're going to. The other thing, I have a son who just graduated from high school, and for the police, for Captain Peterson, I never heard until he asked me. He got invited to a bowl party. Mm-hmm. And I said, I thought like a football. I'm thinking, bowl party? What's where people, the kids, dump pills in a bowl that they get from home or wherever, and they blindly take a pills mm-hmm. out of a bowl. Maybe you can speak more to that. And I thought, how much of that's probably narcotics, antidepressants, you know, Xanax, all that kind of stuff. These high school kids are just taking a handful of whatever they can get their hands on.
Yeah, I would agree. And that's information that we regularly hear about. And it's not just that it comes to the narcotics unit. Our uniformed officers experience those, as opposed to the alcohol and the kegger parties that you would have heard about years ago. You have more of what Dr. Borcher was describing, in that the drug takebacks would encourage everybody to bring your unused and unwanted prescriptions to dispose of as best we can, and instead your prescriptions and your medicine cabinets may be raided by not just someone that's visiting, but unfortunately by a family member or one of their friends. And we do have those types of bowls and those types of incidents that exist.
Dr. Borchers or Captain Peterson. Captain Peterson, you mentioned that this is a trend that's moving west, if I heard you correctly. So my sense is, the assumption is that we'll see more of this happening, and are there things as a community that we should try to do to be prepared for this, other than coming today and learning more about this? Are there active steps as community members that we can take? Any thoughts about that?
Right, and the sense that I'm describing is that, of course, it's going to be the illegal substitution of the prescriptions and the pain medications, and believing and have no reason not to believe that as the prescription monitoring limits and squeezes the sources of legal or prescribed drugs, that there's going to be heroin and other opiate-based drugs that take the place of those. I wish I had great answers about that. I think this is a very good place to start, and there are communities east of us that probably wish that they'd been able to have these conversations sooner. But much like we had in the spring of 2015, and we were very much behind the curve there as well with regards to synthetic cannabinoids, it became front and center important at the time, because we had more than 100 to 120 medical emergencies inside about 3 weeks. And it took not just a law enforcement response, of course. There was medical, there was public, there was media. There's been legislation since then and a greater education and awareness regarding those things. And I think it's going to take that type of involvement by everyone, and not just one particular entity, that is going to be able to have some broad impact. I don't have a doomsday perspective on it, but I do believe that we are going to see some things get worse before the pain management and the substitution for those drugs makes us better.
I guess I'm looking at this maybe bigger picture. Is there a responsibility from the pharmaceutical companies for talking about monitoring individual people about what they get in terms of prescriptions? But is there another layer to this that's maybe above me?
Good question. That is a good question. Pharmaceutical companies are in the business in general for money, but they also are trying to improve patient care. Now, is it geared more one way than the other? I couldn't really tell you. That's a decision you'd have to try to come up with for yourself. There are pharmaceutical companies that help to sponsor and improve the education of programs such as the Prescription Drug Monitoring Program. And they'll provide education on some of the new guidelines that the CDC is having. They also release new drugs that you have to question, are they really necessary? Is it necessary to have another long-acting hydrocodone product? Do you need more long-acting oxycodone products? And sometimes they'll come up with these products to try to prevent them from being abused or misused by formulating them so they can't be melted and then injected. Or they may be mixed with another ingredient. Maybe they'll have an opioid with naloxone that counteracts some of the euphoric effects of it. So some of them may have good intentions. Some of them you have to question, are they really necessary at this time?
I have a question for Melody. Melody, I was wondering, you come from a small town, and you said that when you were actively using, there was a number of individuals in your town that were doing that as well. Do you think that it was also hidden in the small town? Do you think people knew that it was happening? Or how did people in the community then respond to you, I'm interested to know, when they discovered you had an addiction?
Right. At first, before I had my issues with addiction, you know, I didn't see that it was around that much. But once I started using, then it seemed like there is quite a few people in our small town that does have it. It is prescribed. It's very important that they do monitor their drugs and communicate. That way people can't just go to the pharmacy and pick up three scripts of it, you know. So, and people, they might look at me different, but I have come out stronger over all of it.
Good for you.
Yeah.
More questions?
And this is not what the issue is today, I know, but the mental health in general. I think so many of my patients, again, would rather say I've got back pain than I've got depression, because there's still such a stigma, even in 2016, it's my perception still. I can't say I'm depressed. I can't say I'm suicidal. I can't say I'm anxious, but I can say I've got pain. So I need to talk to patient entry to get a patient to know that their pain is not all physical. Again, I think there's such a stigma of patients admitting or coming out with that they are depressed, and you know, I don't know how we solve that problem, but.
Melody, do you find that to be true?
Yes,
I do. Yeah. Other questions?
I have a question, and it's really more for everybody, and maybe more for Dr. Sack. So I know this friend of mine that has, you know, an addiction like this. What do I do now? Where do I refer him to? What is the next step? So right now, I kind of want to go out and do a step that I know I can do. You know, he might not know that he's addicted, you know, so there's all that situation. But so it's a bigger problem. But what can I do right now coming out of this session to try to help someone that I know that is suffering from this?
There are resources in the community. I don't know that I have the answer to that, but I think it starts with, and I'm sure someone has the answers to that, of the right place to go. I know, you know, Rhonda does a very good job at First Step. That's a start, and maybe you can actually provide some a comment on that. But I think part of it starts with education of the patient or the individual. I can't tell you how many times I see patients who feel like that's the only option. You know, so they come to me and they have been on a pain medication for a long time, and whether they're addicted or dependent or whatever it is, it does not matter. But ultimately, they are so used to it. Basically, now it has become the point where, you know, they are taking them on a scheduled basis when that's not how they're supposed to be taken, you know. So they get a prescription for a 30-day supply, and they feel like when the 30 days is up, they're ready for their refill. I mean, they need to get that refill no matter what. And so I had a patient yesterday who she had gotten 120 hydrocodone, 130 oxycodone on her last refill from her other provider, And I asked her, how much are you using? And she said, well, I use 1 to 4 pills per day. And I said, well, you got 250 pills last month. So that's weight you have to have left over. She's like, oh yeah, every month I have a bunch left over. So I have a stockpile of medications. Well, you know, what's happening now is they're just, you know, it starts with education. So these medications are to be taken for when pain happens, for as-needed pain, for the most part, the short-acting ones. And so I can't tell you how many times I say to a patient, well, have you tried this? No. Have you tried this? No. Have you tried physical therapy? No. This has seemed to work for me in the past. And I say, how much pain are you in today? And they say, my pain is 8 or 9 out of 10. And that's hard for me to accept that these medications are really doing much, you know. So I think that probably doesn't answer your question entirely, but I think providing these individuals with options is important.
I think there are great resources in Lincoln as a community. We're blessed by having resources. We don't have enough. There aren't enough treatment resources at all, but. There are great places to start. Our agency, the Bridge Behavioral Health, is one of those agencies in Lincoln that serves a whole variety of men and women that come from a lot of different points in their addiction to get help. And often the help comes from a family member or a friend or someone who, like you said, I don't know exactly what to do next, but I care enough, I'm concerned enough that I'm gonna help you try to do something. And so Dr. Zach mentioned part of this is conversation or education. I think another part is conversation. So when we get these calls, we're open 24 hours a day. We often get calls from the community saying, I'm concerned about somebody, what can I do? And one of the points we try to make is that there's always something to do. It's not always comfortable. It's not always easy. Sometimes we're apprehensive about, will they be mad at me? But our encouragement is to at least have that conversation, to say, I'm concerned about you. I don't know for sure, but it sounds like that's more than you should be taking in terms of pills or number of pills or that you've gotten a refill 8 times in a row, something like that. That's just a logical statement that at least starts to open the door for, if nothing else, my concern, hopefully at least lets you know that something about this doesn't seem right. How can we get help? And so I encourage people to start there. It doesn't always mean that will be the end that we hope, but we feel better that at least we've done something. And for all of us, doing that something is certainly better than doing nothing, because it won't change without some change. So it's a place to start.
Other questions?
My question is just whether the prescribers have good information about resources available so that when that situation arises that you described in your office, do you have enough information to give to that person immediately, who they might call? I mean, is there a need to improve communication pieces to have that available for our medical community?
I think it's a little unfair on my end because I just started my practice 3 or 4 months ago, so I'm still getting to know the community. But I do know, I agree. I think part of the issue is that, yes, that we don't know what the resources are necessarily. Now, as I start to develop the practice and get to know the community, then, you know, those options become available to me. But I do think it's a problem. And like I said, the easy thing always is to just do the easy thing, right? Is give out the pain medication rather than say, there's more to this. It's more complicated than it looks, and we need to take more of an aggressive approach to trying to treat the underlying problem. So.
It was interesting. I was reading, Marcia gave me an article that was just in the New York Times this week, and maybe some of you saw it, but it talked about in Boston how one of the issues was folks would come to the emergency department, or they would come places ready for help, and then the question is, how do we get them that help? And so they've created something, and I'm not saying that this is for Lincoln, but I do think people are starting to think outside the box a little bit. They created what's called the Faster Paths Opioid Urgent Care Center, which is next to the hospital's emergency department. And what it does is it offers care It assesses whether or not, you know, the opioids are in fact the problem. Counseling, case management, home visits, transportation. It also provides the drugs, and then it also includes helping patients with housing and other social services. So it becomes kind of this wraparound center. So some larger cities are beginning to think a little bit outside the box. But certainly I think we've uncovered some things today that as a community we can begin to work on as well. Is there another question? One more before we... Kate?
Sorry, I'm the mic lady.
Melody, you mentioned, I'm assuming it's a drug that you're using that's been incredibly important in your life. Can you talk more about that?
This is hydrocodone. Now, right now I'm taking Suboxone, which is the strip. The way I can explain it is it shuts down the part of my brain that makes me think of running and using nonstop, repetitive. And this completely blocks that out, and I can choose to be clean now, which is an amazing thing to say, you know.
That's great. Melody, is that also a prescription drug? You get it by prescription from a physician?
From Dr. Schmidt at First Step. That's where I've got the most help. I've been in and out of hospitals trying to get help, but they don't know what to do, you know.
I do have a couple more questions.
Sorry, guys. Mine is not a question. It's just a comment. I work at First Step, and Dr. Schmidt is one of our prescribers. He's board certified for addiction medicine. We help adolescents, adults. We have an outpatient program. I know Centerpoint and The Bridge. So I want to thank everybody, but I also want to let you know that we also help folks that do not have insurance, and we accept all insurances, and we typically don't have a wait list. So just anybody here, if there's anybody that ever wants somebody that needs counseling for any reason, substance abuse, we are here to help. So thank you. Thank you, Melody.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
I want to just talk a little bit. Some people you might be familiar with methadone as a treatment for heroin addiction. There are a whole array of medications that can be used to treat addiction. Suboxone is one of them. There are also medications that help to curb alcohol cravings. And it's a new field, and we need more prescribers like Dr. Schmidt who are certified in addiction medicine because for a long time in the substance use world, there was kind of a divide. If you were using a medication to treat your addiction, then you weren't really clean. And that is that's a killer perspective because people need these medications and they work. And so I think it is important for funders and for educators to be thinking in those terms, in terms of having more people educated and certified in those ways. I think it's really essential that our community continue moving that direction. There are not enough providers certified and licensed to prescribe those medications, and it's essential that we do that. We do have someone at Centerpoint that does that on a limited basis right now. So.
Also, Abigail, there are not enough insurance companies, not enough access to the treatment, and so for most of those in Lincoln that need that level of care, not only are there not prescribers, but there's not access to those medications, and that's a critical issue in our community and nationally as well.
Wondering what all of your professional opinion was on holding, you know, other doctors and psychologists and prescribing physicians when they do overprescribe patients. How can we hold them accountable?
Well, there is something with the PDMP that we expect to see starting later next year, where there's, and other states do this. So Nebraska is still exploring this, but other states will have a prescriber report card, and it'll say here are the average number of prescriptions that your peers or other pain management specialists or family practice doctors do. So it's comparing you to others, and you've prescribed X number of prescriptions for opioids compared to the average. There's going to be a scorecard like that. It's not meant to be punitive It's more informational just to say this is where you are compared to the others. Some will be very low, some will be very high. If you have to look at the different communities, you know, there might be a family practice physician who's the only physician in the area, and so he's doing everything from OB, pediatrics, to pain management, because he's the specialist in everything. That's just because of the resources available. So you have to take a look at that if Nebraska decides to do that. But that's something that other states have done on looking at that. Looking at what Medicaid has done, for example, following the CDC guidelines of reducing the number of doses that can be prescribed at one time of an opioid prescription. And that physician's prescription will be rejected by the system. And so then that may have to be specially authorized or a smaller quantity to be prescribed.
And to build on that, there are occasionally investigations that we're tasked with, or in particular the Drug Enforcement Administration is tasked with as well, regarding administrative rules that they have and the occasional rogue pharmacy or physician that is prescribing them like you described. And while they're, like Dr. Borcher just described, there's a lot of times a very good explanation for that appearance. There are times when our investigations have resulted in an arrest for those as well. A lot of times the investigation will result in an administrative type of penalty or a regulatory type of penalty instead, though.
Well, I would like to start to end today. I'm going to give Phil the final word, but if all of you or any of you would like to just give us all food for thought as we walk out on something we can do today, tomorrow, this year, in the coming future, close future here, in order to begin to address this problem before we do get to a place where we're reacting like we had to with the K2 synthetic marijuana. Is there a way for us to walk away today with some can-do things for either ourselves or our agencies?
I would recommend that doctors help wing their patients off. I don't know if that's a possibility, but taper them down.
Okay. Yeah, I think being vigilant, being informed, and you know, providing education and starts with the conversation, the education to patients that there are options out there that that we can try, other options.
I think having very frank conversations between you, your doctor, your APRN, your pharmacist, to look at those issues, and have reversed of that, have the physician, the pharmacist, talk to you about what they're seeing and what may be able to be helpful.
And I think it's going to take personal courage by everybody, like Mariah was describing, to have those awkward conversations and to hold other people accountable, not just your close friends and your loved ones, but the others that you're seeing that are participating in risky behavior. It's not unlike other risk assessments that we make with our kids or the elderly or the ill or those with mental health problems. I think you just have to step up and have the courage to do that and find out what you can do for them. By the time it overlaps with something where I get involved, it's going to be more reactive. And while there can be some coercive treatment requirements, it's going to require the desire to do it.
Well, I want to thank you all. And Phil, I'm going to leave it with you, but I do want to thank you all so much for being here, for sharing not only your expertise and your time, but your personal story. That's incredibly helpful to us as we think through this. And Phil, do you want to close us today?
Dr. Zach, I was struck by one of the comments you made. If I heard you correctly, one of the issues we face today is that these medications are really effective. And every day, my assumption is, Dr. Borcher's building on what you said, that every day they become more so. That's part of this business process that pharmaceutical companies go through to make them more effective. And so my sense is that folks were at a trend where every day that will continue. And yet we've all heard today that there are issues with the use of these medications if they're used non-medically or even medically to the point that's beyond their expectation. And so I think the hope in coming here today, folks, is that forewarned is forearmed, if you will, that the intent, I'm assuming, in drawing you here was to learn more, and now we know more. And so I think two things are important as we leave here today. One is that certainly we've identified now other resources in these conversations as members of the panel, and I heard that there'll be an email that goes back out to attendees with some information that we can no longer say, I didn't know what to do. I didn't know the next step. And I think the second point is that it's incumbent on all of us. We can all say that there's nothing I can do, and yet we've heard across this forum from Melody on down that there are things we can do, even if it's a matter of taking what you've learned today and carrying that conversation forward, or to the point of having that difficult but so critical conversation with someone that we're concerned about. There are resources. There is help. There is hope. And yet we've got to be the ones to move that from the step we're on to the next step. And so we all have more information today than we had when we walked in. And so to that end, Lori, I want to thank the Health Endowment for that work. And certainly if you join me in thanking members of the panel for their expertise today.
It's right here in Nebraska.
It's right here in Lincoln.
It could be in your home.
An estimated one-third of all prescription drugs and over-the-counter medicines go unused.
They're just sitting there.
And they could wind up in the wrong hands.
Or get taken accidentally.
And flushing them or throwing them out can harm the environment.
So what can you do?
Take them back.
Take them back.
Take them back.
Take them back.
Take your leftover and unwanted medication to a participating pharmacy or drug take-back event.